Good morning. Good morning. Good morning and welcome to worship on this Pride Sunday. It is a privilege to lead worship this morning. I hope it is meaningful and spirit-filled time for all of us. We're going to take a moment right now for pride. On June 10th, 1925, the United Church of Canada was born after much consultation, compromise, and listening for the Spirit. In 1988, the United Church of Canada decided that sexual orientation would no longer be a barrier to membership in the United Church, and hence to candidacy for ministry. In 2009, gender identity was added to that decision. Today, we celebrate Pride in many United Churches across the country.
Some of us today come celebrating and knowing lots about Pride. Some come today celebrating and knowing a little about Pride. Excuse me. And some of us today come not sure what to expect, but are here to learn what we can. So let's begin with a bit of background. Pride is a positive stance against discrimination and violence towards lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, and gender-fluid people. Pride is also a chance to promote self-affirmation, dignity, equality, and fundamental human rights, and to celebrate in a safe environment.
The Pride Parade has its roots in a 1970 march in New York City, which marked this LGBTQ community's first resistance to police brutality, oppression, and human rights violations that had resulted in the Stonewall riots a year earlier in 1969. Since the 1980s, this liberation movement has morphed into the Pride movement. Parades, festivities, and celebrations are held to mark improved rights for this marginalized community, supported by allies of all walks of life, as well as lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer people. With this context today, we are celebrating Pride.
Bringing light into our midst, reminding us that we are all God's beloved children. And we gather in our diversity, knowing that we are loved and beloved by God. This light reminds us that this light gets in all darkness. God is with us and we are never alone. And we also come recognizing that our buildings are on traditional territories of the first peoples of this nation. And so we here in Southampton acknowledge the traditional territory of the Anishinaabeg people, the people of the three fires known as the Ojibwe, the Ottawa, and the Potawatomi nations. And we further give thanks to the Chippewas of the Saugeen and the Chippewas of Nawash, now known as the Saugeen Ojibwe Nation, as the traditional keepers of this land.
And those of us from Rockton, Kirkwall, Lynden, and Sheffield are gathered upon the traditional territories of the Anturonon, the Haudenosaunee, and the Mississaugas. This land is covered by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant, which is an agreement to share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes.
And here at Trinity, we acknowledge that we gather on the traditional territories, subject to land and treaty claims, of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe and Shenanton peoples. We acknowledge our participation in the climate crisis and its effect on Indigenous peoples around the world because of their close relationship with the land and its resources. We seek reconciliation in all its forms.
We will be lighting candles to represent diversity, inclusion, kindness, acceptance, joyfulness, and belonging. We will light a rainbow. And we will begin with the red candle. We light the red candle symbolizing life in all of its richness. Come, let us worship and learn and celebrate together. As we begin by singing our opening hymn, We Are One As We Come, hymn number 402 in Voices United.
Thank you.
Jesus calls us to meet him here. We gather as brothers and sisters in Christ. We come as we are, as we were made. We come to offer ourselves to Jesus. We come knowing that our offering means sacrifice, knowing it means hard decisions and choices. We come ready to offer ourselves, all that we are, and all that we do. We offer now to Jesus.
Leave the world behind. Come and follow Jesus. We will leave all to follow Jesus. Untie the binds that stop you from following. We will untie all that binds us. Walk towards freedom and worship God. We will walk forward together and offer this time of worship to our Creator. Next, we light the orange candle, symbolizing healing. As Scripture assures, if I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast.
God of all grace, we come before you this day, in our homes and in these buildings, seeking your wisdom, leaning on your strength, and giving thanks for your presence as we once again dedicate ourselves to you, as we journey on through life and through faith.
God of all love, we come before you in need, wondering about pain in the world, crying out about violence in the world, worrying about the present and the future. Be with us in our struggles, guide us in our choices, love us in our mistakes. God of all forgiveness, we come before you as we are, made up of all our choices, all our decisions, all our tests and trials, highs and lows, fears and doubts. Forgive us, we pray, for all those things we each bring to you now.
In this season of hope, of rejoicing in the presence of you, our God, three in one, Father, Son, and Spirit, we give thanks for the knowledge that we are forgiven, always and completely, when we choose to follow you. And so it is with that knowledge and your presence that we have the confidence to pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Now we light the yellow candle, symbolizing sunlight, the brightness of God that shines on everyone.
So good morning, everyone. I understand we have a few children with us today in Sheffield. And so I would invite the children of Sheffield, whom I understand are Gideon and Nora and Lily and Scarlett and James and Grace and is it Killen or Kellen? Well, we invite you to come forward because we're going to talk today about pride. Is it possible to put Sheffield on, Meryl? Thank you. Hello, everyone.
Sit in the front here and we'll...
Is there any way that we can see them on the screen, Jean? Like, could they come up and stand in front of the communion table?
Sure, perfect, then. Come on up here. And you can, then they, you can, everybody can see you on your screen. Come on up here. Come on up. Hi.
Thank you.
How are you, James? Come on up.
It's great to see so many little people
Don't
today.
Be
Welcome.
This is Phil.
Yeah. So we're going to talk a little bit about pride today. Does any of you girls and boys there know what pride is?
James.
Pride is when someone doesn't know what you're doing and doesn't know it's Pride Day.
Okay. That's a great explanation. Anybody else?
Do you know what pride is? Okay. Let's hear what you say. Okay. All right.
So, I missed that. Okay. Okay. So, we call June Pride Month. And Pride, the word, is actually originally was an acronym that stood for Personal Rights in Defense and Education. An organization that started in 1966 to fight for equal rights for LGBTQ plus people in California. But there's also the double meaning of pride, and that's the pride that we want to talk about today. The pride of what it is just to be who you are. The pride of self. And that, I think, is probably the most important thing, that everybody is able to be who they truly are and be proud of themselves. So, pride is that which describes a feeling of deep pleasure or satisfaction people get from their achievements or their best qualities. Pride is also defined as the consciousness of one's own dignity. Being proud of who you are, regardless of anything, regardless of what other people say about you, regardless of anything. And I think that's what's so wonderful about Pride Month, is that it gives people permission to be proud of who they are. So, you guys, is there something that you're proud about who you are? James, is there something about James that you are proud to be James?
What are you proud of?
Me.
You. And so you should be.
What makes you happy about yourself? Anybody got an idea?
Well,
what makes you happy about yourself?
I would say, because I've only really met James before a little bit, he should be proud of his confidence.
Oh, I love my freckles. Anybody else? Your smile. Yeah. No answers, Heather. Sorry.
It's okay. I was saying that I think James should be proud of his confidence. I think the person who smiled should be proud of the ability to smile. Every single one of us has reasons that we can be proud of ourselves for who we are. And I think that's really what's most important about today. And so, as some of you know, I think that you guys in Sheffield have some of these things too. There was a campaign a few years ago, and this company has jumped on the Pride wagon, this company that makes Skittles, because they talk about the rainbow, and they talk about Pride. And I wanted to just share one more thing about the rainbow flag. It has long been a symbol for being proud, not only in June, but throughout the year. So the Pride flag was designed by Gilbert Baker in 78 in San Francisco for the Gay Freedom Celebration. And originally the Pride flag had 8 colors, and each color symbolized something different. Pink for sexuality, red for life, orange for healing, yellow for the sun, green for nature, turquoise for art, indigo for harmony, and violet for the soul. The most recent rainbow flag also includes pink and blue for transgender people, and black and brown to represent black and Latina people. It's quite a history. It's quite a remarkable history. It's amazing what a diverse rainbow can do. And so they will be at the back, and we will have a chance to taste the rainbow, which is the Skittles logo, because all the different flavors and all the diverse colors are all one. So our choir is going to sing an anthem right now. And thank you guys for all your help this morning.
We have Skittles that we're handing out, Heather.
Wonderful.
Still my soul, the Lord is on your side.
Don't.
We light the green candle, symbolizing nature. We are all creations of Creator, who colors the world in so many shades of green. God offers to us, through prophets and apostles, words of life which in faith become the living word. Let us listen to that word. Our Old Testament reading is from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 to 2, and verses 6 to 14. Now when the Lord was about to take up Elijah to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please, let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted to you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. He picked up the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water, saying, "Where is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" When he struck the water was parted to one side and to the other, and Elisha went over. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God for the word.
Our responsive reading this morning is Psalm 77, page 791. I cry aloud to God. I cry that God may hear me.
In my time of distress, I have turned to God. With hands uplifted, I have prayed all night. But my soul refuses all comfort.
Then I recall your deeds, O God. I remember your wonders of old. I recount all your works and ponder the things that you have done.
O God, your ways are holy. What God is as great as you?
You are the one who works wonders. You have shown your strength among nations.
By your arm you redeemed your people, the children of Jacob and Joseph.
The waters saw you, O God. The waters saw you and churned in fear.
The seas trembled to their depths.
Clouds streamed water, the heavens rumbled.
Your arrows bolted on every side.
The voice of your thunder was heard in the whirlwind.
Lightning lit up the world, the earth quaked and shuddered.
Your way was through the sea.
Your path through mighty waters.
Your footprints could not be seen.
But by the hand of Moses and Aaron, you led your people like a flock.
The epistle lesson taken from Galatians 5, verse 1 and 13 to 25. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. This is the witness of the church. Thanks be to God.
And the gospel lesson is from Luke chapter 9, verses 51 to 62. When the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him, but they did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." Jesus said to him, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ the Word. May God bless to our understanding all the readings from Holy Scripture. Please join in the next hymn from More Voices, number 120, "My Soul Cries Out." Thank you.
We light the blue candle symbolizing harmony. Blue skies, blue water, big blue marble that we all live upon, all one in God.
The first time I came here, it was like 2 weeks after I came out to my mom. I didn't know anybody out at the time. It was only grade eight, so I was very confused and, you know, like kind of scared.
To me, Rainbow Camp means a place that I could be myself and I can talk, hang out, and just be unapologetically me.
Can you dig that crazy gibberish? Can you dig it? Can you dig it?
As I got older, it was a little awkward going to gender-based camps when I started to realize I was trans. But after quite a bit of Googling, I found out about Rainbow Camp. And while I've been to many summer camps before, there was never a summer camp where, like, I really felt like I was at home. And Rainbow Camp is the only camp I ever cared enough to go back to for a second year. And it's been worth it every time.
And that's where we're asking for your help. By contributing to our campaign, you're helping to ensure Rainbow Camp will continue this year and for many more summers to come.
This is Harry Stewart, and Harry Stewart is a friend of mine from Thessalon, and he started this incredible project up in the Thessalon area, and he's going to tell us about it.
Back in 2009, we created an organization called Welcome Friend Association, and that was some members of Oklahoma Presbytery and a couple from the LGBT community in the area. And we ran two conferences, one in 2009 and one in 2011. And it became pretty apparent that there was no LGBT youth. There was no youth to be found. And to be honest, it seemed more like church than it did what I was hoping for. So at Seniors Moment, I said to my partner, I said, you know, we should get kids involved. So our local minister at the time, he was the chairperson of Camp McDougall, which is a United Church camp just a couple kilometers away from Thessalon. And I asked him if we could rent camp. And he said, yes. And that was in 2012.
So tell me about the camp. Who's the camp for, and what goes on at the camp, and some of the people that use the camp?
Sure, I can do that. So camp, Rainbow Camp is a camp for 2SLGBTQ+, for ages 12 to 17. We run two different camps in age groups, 12 to 14, 15 to 17. And we started back in 2012. We had 14 campers, 1 week, and we were at Camp McDougall for 3 years, I believe. And we eventually outgrew them because they wanted to do their own programming and we were growing with ours. So we've gone to a private camp, excuse me. And this year we are offering 6 weeks of programming plus 1 week of an outdoor trip. Camp, what do I say about camp? So our kids come from all across Canada and the U.S., and this year we have one camper coming from Saudi Arabia. We help subsidize and can pay for registration if the families of the kids can't afford it. We also pay for travel to and from camp from anywhere in Canada. We will help with the U.S. after the fact because you never know if they're going to get across the border. So we do our due diligence. We won't turn any camper away due to financial reasons. What happens at camp is truly, truly amazing. The United Church, my background, we talk about safe space and we kick that around, but safe space at camp is really, really important. And we do that by allowing the kids to be who they want to be. And trust me, that changes almost daily. For some of these kids who have never been able to express themselves, whether it's expressing themselves physically or being able to talk about who they are, we allow that to happen. The last day is just amazing. I always make sure I'm there for it. They talk about how camp is home, how they met, how they got new friends, how they felt alone, how they feel stronger. And it's just so empowering, for not only for them, but for Chris and I, just to see, and for staff, to see how what a difference we're making.
interesting and concerning developments this past week in the States. A law was repealed in New York, and people are now able to carry concealed weapons. And then, of course, the big news was that Roe v. Wade was overturned. The abortion law, or rightly said, the law that allows women to make a determination about her own body and her own reproductive rights. A meme on Facebook puts it this way: a gun now has more rights in the US than a woman. What are they so afraid of, these lawmakers, that feel that they have the right to decide what women do with their uteruses and about who gets to decide when life begins? It's also very telling that this is about controlling women with uteruses and not about human life. Because if the law was actually about human life, it would include something about caring for all of these children that will be born. Because there was not legislation created to support and nurture these children and help them grow and have a safe and fulfilling life. It's not really a pro-life thing, it's a pro-birth thing. June is Pride Month. And even though in Toronto today there will be a big, huge party and lots of color and celebrating and a big old parade, in some places in this country, it is still dangerous to be gay. It is still not safe to be homosexual. It is not safe to be transsexual. It is not safe to be transgendered. In Norway, the Pride parade was canceled after a gunman shot and killed 2 and wounded 10 outside a bar in Oslo that was popular for the LGBTQ community. This is from the NPR website, and they write, "Police attorney Christian Hacho said that the suspect was being held on suspicion of murder and attempted murder and terrorism based on the number of people targeted at these locations, at multiple locations. An overall assessment, he says, is that there are grounds to believe that he wanted to cause grave fear in the population. He wanted to cause fear by targeting LGBTQ people. Fear. Fear is a powerful thing. It is natural and powerful and a primitive human emotion. It involves a universal biochemical response as well as a high individual emotional response. Fear alerts us to the presence of danger or the threat of harm, whether the danger is physical or psychological. Fear is a curious thing. It is something that we humans have to protect us, to help us run from danger or fight back when we're being pushed around. But it's also something that we seek. Any of you out there are scary movie watchers who love that adrenaline rush of these terrifying moments? Or any of you out there, are you jump out of plane people who like that, or climb high mountains who seek this adrenaline rush? Fear is a curious thing. Today we meet Alicia dealing with his fear. We are watching him face his fear of death, his fear of change, his fear of moving into the role that he is not ready for. Up until the time that we meet him today, he's been a student. He's been the mentored, the observer of the prophet Elijah. Years ago, when he was plowing in his father's field, the first time he met Elijah, Elijah walked up to him and placed his mantle on him. In that moment, Elisha made a choice not to stay in the fields that he knew and continue to plow and to follow in the footsteps of his father. Elisha made the choice to leave all of that behind and become someone else as the student or the seeker that walked alongside Elijah. Who, as you may recall from our last sermon, defeated the 250 priests of Baal and angered the queen of Jezebel. So being the sidekick of the prophet who has angered the king and queen is not actually a very safe thing to be. It was a dangerous choice to make, going about the political powers of his day to follow this prophet. And so for the last few years, Elisha has learned so much from this mentor of his, but today is different. Something is about to change in both Elijah and Elisha's life. Elisha will have another choice to make. We join the story as Elijah realizes that it is time for him to die, time for him to leave this earth. He knows it. And he tries to spare Alicia the pain of parting, so he invites him to stay behind as he journeys to the next town and then on to the next town. From Gilgal to Bethel, from Bethel to Jericho, from Jericho to the Jordan. At each place, Elijah gives Elisha an out, a place where he can remain. But Elisha is determined. I will go with you, he says. And even though there are 50 in the company of prophets who are almost taunting Elisha, don't you know, can't you see, aren't you aware? Elijah is about to go away. Are you ready? Be silent, says Elisha. Shut up. I don't want to know about it. I don't want to hear this. I wonder what Elisha is so afraid of why he's so intent on ignoring the inevitable, pretending that this is just a normal day where he and Elijah get to go from place to place to place. When they finally arrive at the Jordan River, Elijah rolls up his mantle, strikes the water, and just like Moses, the waters of the Jordan part, and the two men walk across the riverbank, walk across from the riverbank on dry land. The company of prophets, however, remain on the other shore. Elijah turns to Elisha and asks what he can give him as a parting gift. What final words or actions can Elisha receive from his teacher, his mentor? So Elisha, I think in his fear, asks for a double portion of what Elijah has, not trusting that he is enough as himself to do the work that God has called him to. Elijah, this is, I think, the piece of the fear that's the most important. Elijah says, if you are able to watch me, if you are able to face what you fear, if you are able to watch as my life transforms into what is next, and you are left here, if you are able to cope with what you are dreading, then you will receive this double portion. And then, in true biblical storytelling fashion, Elijah dies in a spectacle of flaming horses and flaming chariots and whirlwinds. And Elisha stands there and witnesses this death, watching as his friend and mentor leaves this earth. And he faces the fear of death to the old, and he faces the fear of being alone, and he faces the fear of relying on himself, and he faces the fear of not being ready and not being enough. He tears his old clothes in two and picks up the mantle of Elijah. And he walks back to the Jordan, and he strikes the water, which again, part for Elisha, and on dry land, he moves to the other side. Elisha the prophet faced his fears. Fear is a complicated thing. If you are seeking to overcome fear, the internet has all sorts of advice and information. Fear also gives you the unique opportunity to develop an inner force that can expand your life. That force is courage. Facing fear gives you courage. The final few months of my mother's life were physically difficult for her. Her breast cancer had metastasized to her liver. She chose to try another round of chemo, but after the first dose, it was obvious that the chemo was making her sicker than her illness, so she stopped, knowing that the cancer would win and win sooner rather than later. July and August of 2012 was the time of my mother's rapidly declining health and subsequent death. There is fear when you know you are dying. There was fear in my mother. There was fear in myself and my sisters and my father. Fear of the unknown, fear of missing out and leaving behind those you love and what this person will not be part of in your life to come. fear of pain and body discomfort. There is fear in dying. And yet in the midst of this, my mother found some inner strength. And she and I would attribute this to God and her faith, and she faced her fear of death and pain, and she made some choices. She made the choice to prepare her family and her friends and herself for her death. She planned her place. She knew where she wanted to die and where she hoped to spend her final days. And then she also had a plan B, and she got hospice on board. She planned her funeral. Her family loved to sing, so she planned a hymn sing right in the middle of the funeral service. We had 15 minutes of singing a couple of verses of 15 hymns that were favorites of hers. She handpicked her choir. She handpicked the minister. She had both the choir director and the minister out to the house to speak with her about her service in August. She even decided on the menu for the post-funeral luncheon. We talked as family about her wishes. She made a living will. She had the funeral director out to discuss her plans. She spent time that summer with everyone in our family, and on the day of her death, she called us all home and waited until we were all in the room before she breathed her last breath. My mother died with courage and dignity, and I think without fear, because she died in love. And here's what these stories have to teach us today. That fear can go in so many different ways. It can go to hate and protest, and terrible things can happen, like the shooting in Oslo. Or it can be faced and confronted and walked through, so that scared moments such as someone leaving this earth, whether in chariots of fire or lying in your own bed, slowly losing your breath, they become sacred moments, courage moments, where God is there and we are never alone. God moments. May it be so. Amen. Our next hymn is number 691, Walls That Divide.
Walls that divide are broken.
We light the purple candle, symbolizing spirit. In love, we are all part of God's world. We are all included in the circle of life, in the amazing and the inclusive spirit of love.
Help us, we pray, to continue to make this choice through whatever tests and trials we face.
This week, as violence continues, as inhumanity is commonplace, as war rages at home and all across the world, be with us, be beside us, and lead us always to your path, and give strength and wisdom and humility to those who incite hatred and start wars, to see that we always have a choice to change and to repent.
Holy Spirit, our sustenance and strength, breathe your fire of hope and joy into our church, here in these congregations, this province, this country, and this world. Help all your people to choose to continue on the path of faith through every test and every doubt.
Almighty God, in this time of trial, we pray for all those known to us and unknown who are bereaved, lonely, isolated, excluded, or are in need of you in any way. Hear now the prayers in each of our hearts.
God, in good times and in bad, who stands with us in every trial and every test, be with each of us now and help us in every choice we make, today and every day. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
This is the time in our worship service where we offer something of ourselves back into the mix, where we place something on a plate, where we open up our hearts and offer that into the world, which is in desperate need of our love and our care and our concern and our kindness. This is our offering time. It will now be received.
Giving God, in our lives and in our choices, we strive to follow you, and we come before you in thanks for all you have given, and for your constant presence in our lives, and so we make this offering, laid here and by other means, in the hope that it will be used for your good and your sake. Amen. Our last hymn today is from More Voices, number 154, Deep in Our Hearts.
Deep in Our Hearts.
This morning, we have lit candles. Red for life in all its forms. Orange for healing. Yellow for sunlight and all kinds of light. Green for nature in all her diversity. Blue for harmony. And purple for the spirit which guides us. We are called to practice this rainbow of colors in our lives, in the conversations and interactions, in our lives at home, at work, and at play. As we go out into our community and the world to share the message that God's love is for everyone.
From here to eternity, from pew to street corner, from young and old, your word is shared. May we never give up when the going gets tough. May we remain ever hopeful, ever loving, ever ready to serve you. Send us now in your name.
So as we go from this place and this time this morning, go knowing that the God of diverse human love goes with you. Go knowing the justice that comes from the word of the Christ, and go knowing the strength that you need comes from the Holy Spirit. Go from this place to share this great, diverse love. Amen.
Oh, picture hues across the sky.